At the turn of the century, the F-35 program was supposed to change the way that DoD did acquisition, and has failed to do so. The already long 15-year from inception to initial operational capability timeline has slid an additional 8 years, and that lengthy timeline exceeds the commercial aircraft sector by a factor of 4 or 5. Meanwhile, Russia and China have developed airplanes like these two, the Su-57 and the J-20. In so doing, they've demonstrated the ability to rapidly design and build stealthy, high-performance fighters, which has quickly eroded our military aircraft edge. The enemy now has information dominance in some regimes. They can do high-end data transfer. They have cyber agility. So whatever air-to-air platform we develop next, it has to be able to operate in those environments as well. And increasingly, we need to be concerned about things like range of our air-to-air weapons and range of our airplanes. The leading threat driving this requirement is the Chinese PL-15 air-to-air missile, which has a max range of 186 nautical miles. So that's double the capability of our max range air-to-air weapon, which is the AIM-120D. This is a big problem. Then you add on to that China's hypersonic missile capability. They just demonstrated that in a strategic weapon. But they also have hypersonic glide weapons that pose a great threat, particularly to our fleet. So, of course, we're not an authoritarian country that can just dedicate money and resources to an aircraft procurement system. We have more checks and balances than that. But in the face of the high-end threat, this can't take as long as F-35 has taken. So against that backdrop, enter Next Generation Air Dominance, or NGAD for short. This Air Force-led program is described as a family of systems, with a fighter aircraft as the centerpiece, as I just hinted at, and as Secretary of Defense Austin has expressly said, the pacing threat is China. So NGAD is being developed with the Pacific Theater in mind. Now, Air Force officials want to avoid the term sixth generation, and they refer to the fighter part of NGAD as either FX or PCA, which is penetrating counter-air. The Navy variant of this concept is known as FAXX. So let's talk a little bit about the specifics of FAXX. The requirements include supercruise capability, as well as next-generation stealth, sensors, radars with networking adaptability, other missions, it has to be able to do air-to-air refueling, reconnaissance, surveillance, and target acquisition, which is abbreviated as RSTA, has to have some electronic warfare and electronic attack and countermeasures capability. It also has to be able to operate in a manned, unmanned, and, this is a new term, optionally manned environment, and be a highly adaptive platform. The FAXX needs to have maximum sensor connectivity according to the requirements. They're talking about things like what they call electronically configured, quote-unquote, smart skins. Smart skins have the sensors and electronics integrated into the fuselage instead of being kind of bolted on, the little blisters you see on airplanes now, with the idea that that would increase sensor performance while reducing drag and enhancing maneuverability and speed. The mention of supercruise in the requirements points to an engine technology that has been in development for some years. In fact, they tried to put it on the F-35, and it may well be the replacement engine for the F-35. And this idea has been labeled Adaptive Versatile Engine Technology, or ADVENT. Here's what the formula behind this science looks like. The bottom line is this adaptive engine technology means that an engine can vary the volume of airflow that bypasses the core. So this third stream of airflow gives it the supercruise capability, and that architecture can improve specific fuel consumption by 25%, which increases range and reduces, obviously, in-flight refueling requirements. The only thing to note is if you live near an air station, that increasing the specific thrust makes this engine very noisy at takeoff. So it's a trade-off for having the ADVENT capability. So right now, it's binary in terms of engine design. You either design something for cruise mode, like a commercial aircraft engine, or you design something for high-speed performance, like a military jet. So what ADVENT is supposed to do is bridge the gap between those two things. So FAXX will most likely incorporate this engine technology. So up front, the conversation that emerges when you mention NGAD or F-A-X-X is, will this airplane be manned, unmanned, or what? So reading the requirements leads me to believe that this airplane has to be manned. We're talking about a sixth generation capability. And when you say unmanned, that doesn't mean autonomous. AI technology is currently not developed enough where we can build frontline fighters that can fully do the job. So the bridge to this capability, again, sixth generation, will be manned fighters controlling unmanned aircraft. Now, there's already a program called Loyal Wingman that the Australian Air Force is working on with Boeing. The Australians have successfully flown the test aircraft, and the Department of Defense is very interested in this capability. So in the requirements for F-A-X-X is manned, unmanned, optionally manned capabilities. That means the F-A-X-X has got to be able to operate in that environment. So let's say that F-A-X-X is not only going to be a manned airplane, it's also going to need to have two aircrew in it. Already we can see with the difference between the Super Hornet E and the Super Hornet F is the E pilots are task saturated in some mission areas, and the F is used for those missions, like forward air controller airborne, close air support, and other high task loading missions. The F squadrons, like the Tomcat squadrons, are used for those missions. So as we get into this world where your fighter, your F-A-X-X, is controlling 4, 6, 8 unmanned aircraft, the loyal wingman concept, the task loading on a single seat airplane would be too much. So your WISO would be doing the flying of the other airplanes, the loyal wingman, while the pilot flies the airplane they're in and also watches out for SAMs and maintains a radar picture, so forth and so on. So it's a natural that F-A-X-X would have tandem seating like a Tomcat or an F-4. So the bottom line there is, in terms of naval aviation, the NFO warfare specialty is not going away anytime soon. The other part of the discussion that comes up when you start talking about manned aircraft controlling multiple drones is, where are you going to put the drones? So already with the development of the X-47 and the MQ-25, there are questions of how are unmanned aircraft going to integrate with manned aircraft on a conventional aircraft carrier. To me, that's the brave new world. When you talk about doing cyclic ops in the way we do it now, it is kind of a challenge to think about how would the unmanned aircraft seamlessly integrate with manned aircraft during case one, case three, whatever. It's not clear to me how we're going to do that. All we've done so far is test one of these unmanned aircraft among a limited amount of manned aircraft. So if we're talking about the idea to meet the threat is to have a single manned aircraft with 6, 8 unmanned aircraft, you don't have the real estate on even a Ford-class carrier to make that work. This introduces a requirement for things like light aircraft carriers. This discussion has percolated since World War II, where we had Jeep carriers and CVLs. Like, okay, why do we need these supercarriers alone? Shouldn't we supplement them with smaller aircraft carriers? This doesn't mean amphibs. The America class is not what I'm talking about. Those are designed for STOVL airplanes, as well as helicopters and tilt rotors like the V-22. The drones that we're thinking about are conventional aircraft that need catapults. So EMALS technology was developed for lower weight airplanes like drones, just like the advanced arresting gear was developed for lighter weight airplanes like drones. So that's good. We can leverage that technology for this smaller class of carrier that are basically drone carriers that would be in company with Ford class or Nimitz class and would host the drones and operate that way. Marines are already working on their Expeditionary Advanced Base Operations concept. And so this idea of light carriers, drone carriers, with that could provide the answer for where are you going to put the drones in the numbers that you conceive here. The basic shape of the airplane in some of the drawings and test articles that we've seen, it looks stealthy And maybe that doesn't mean pure stealth, but let's say it's going to have a low radar cross-section, low observables. It means that the weapons will be carried internally. Most of the designs that have been socialized don't have vertical stabs. So this starts to get back into the original design of the X-32. The other thing they're going to improve upon, which aviators care about a lot, is the ejection seat. So the next generation ejection seat is being developed by Collins, and they call it the ACES-5. And the improvements are, it can accommodate a full anthropometric range, meaning it can handle pilots who weigh as little as 103 pounds all the way up to 245 pounds. It also increases the operational envelope to 600 knots. So pilots can eject at 600 knots, which is about 150 knots faster than certainly the Martin Baker was in the F-14. And then because of the proliferation of helmet-mounted devices and helmet-mounted displays, which makes more mass on a pilot's head, this has a webbing system that does two things. It contains the cranium on ejection and also wraps the arms and legs in a way that prevents flail injuries. So that's a great capability that will ultimately save lives in the event that pilots wind up having to punch out of the F-A-XX. Now, who's going to build NGAD or the F-A-XX? The military-industrial complex paradigm has shifted massively since the mid-50s when we were able to crank out different type model series at a rapid clip. So with that reality in mind, perhaps DoD needs to look to companies that have surpassed NASA in their ability to create capability and put rockets into space, for instance, to design, develop, build, and deliver this sixth-generation air dominance capability. And remember, when we say air dominance, the F-35 was not built to be an air dominance platform. It was built to be a strike fighter. In the Air Force, it's replacing the F-16, not the F-15. So now NGAD will replace the F-22 that replaced the F-15. In the Navy, that line is blurred by this F/A concept and by the absence of a robust air-to-air threat. That world is changing. So the other thing we need to think about with F-A-XX is the robust air-to-air capability. We've already mentioned the PL-15, the 180-mile air-to-air missile the Chinese have. So we're going to have to field next-generation capability, and we can't take 20 years to do it. So again, this is where we look at a company like SpaceX and innovators like Elon Musk, as controversial as he is, no doubt, to build this capability. In fact, last year at the Air Force Association conference in D.C., a senior procurement official was quoted as saying, "I have to imagine there will be a lot of engineers, maybe famous ones, with well-known household names with billions of dollars to invest, that will decide starting the world's greatest aircraft company to build the world's greatest aircraft with the U.S. military is exactly the kind of inspiring thing that they want to do as a hobby or even a main gig." So there you go. Now, NGAD and FAXX are scheduled to hit the fleet at the end of the 2020s into the 2030s. And they have to, because at that time, all of our Super Hornets will be at high time, and we won't have enough F-35s to meet the requirements that have to be met in the face of this high-end threat that's emerging. So no doubt this is easier said than done when you consider our industrial base and the constraints of how we do defense acquisition. But we really don't have a choice. The threat is real, and it's growing. So as an aviator, I'm excited about the potential for NGAD and FAXX. These technologies I'm hearing about are very exciting. And as I mentioned, I'm also very happy that this looks like it's going to be a manned airplane that's going to require two people to make it work. That does my Rio heart good. All right, that's going to do it for this episode. If you're a first-time viewer, please ring the bell and become a subscriber. Give me the likes and comment. Check the links below for merch, including where to get the Punks Trilogy, my first three novels about a Tomcat squadron, just reissued by the Naval Institute Press. Use the discount code PUNKYT for 25% off at usni.org. If you'd like to help support this channel, please consider using the Super Thanks, the heart icon with the dollar sign below, or become a patron at patreon.com/wardcarroll. And in the meantime, I look forward to talking to you again soon.